All right, we're taking a look at abiding in Christ. So John chapter 15, if you would, once again. And we're looking at that idea of abiding in his purpose. And that's what we're looking at, right? Mm-hmm. And John chapter 15, those first eight verses. I am the true vine, and my Father is the husbandman. Every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away. And every branch that beareth fruit, he purgeth it, that it may bring forth more fruit. Now ye are clean through the word which I have spoken unto you. Abide in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself, except it abide in the vine, no more can ye, except ye abide in me. I am the vine, ye are the branches. He that abideth in me, and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit. For without me ye can do nothing. If a man abide not in me, he is cast forth as a branch, and is withered. And men gather them, and cast them into the fire, and they are burned. If ye abide in me, and my words abide in you, ye shall ask what ye will, and it shall be done unto you. Herein is my Father glorified, that ye bear much fruit. So shall ye be my disciples. So we're able to, you know, bear much fruit. And that's the purpose that we have. Remember, Christ gave us a new purpose. And I'm reviewing a little bit here. That's on the back of page 3, about, just above the blue, above the letter C. Mm-hmm. You know, Christ saved us. Gave us a new purpose. I'm glad he did.
Amen.
Because the purpose I had before wasn't a very good one. But he gave us a new purpose. And of course, we're supposed to give him glory. Isn't that what we just read? Mm-hmm. So we should make Christ preeminent. And that's a great word. You know, it's to be up in front in first place and all that. And we're not to bring glory to ourself, we're to bring glory to God. And that's what we read here. Herein is my Father glorified, verse 8 says, that ye bear much fruit, so shall ye be my disciples. So that's part of our purpose, glorifying God with what we do. So when Tony does all of the work that he does with recording and the internet and all that kind of thing, he's glorifying God, because that's the purpose God's given to him. And those are good things. When Dave does all the things he does, and this morning if he's got a science lesson for us and does that, he'll be glorifying God with that.
Amen.
And that'll be a good thing. Praise the Lord. And the things that you folks all do, you know, not to glorify ourselves. And then, of course, we understand that God should be praised and magnified, and to magnify something. What does that mean?
Examine it.
Yeah. Okay.
Enlarge it.
Yeah, enlarge it. We use a magnifying glass to examine things because we're enlarging it, so we see it even bigger than it is. Is that what you were going to say, Dave? I thought it was,
yeah.
I cut you off, I'm sorry.
No, it doesn't matter. As long as somebody said it.
Amen.
It's not copyright.
Yeah, amen. So that's what we want to do, make God bigger to the world around so everybody can see him like we see him. And
yeah,
that's just important.
I think to show something for what it is.
Yeah.
You know, to easier see what something already is.
Right. Yeah. How many of you remember, we used to get the Sunday paper and it had the funny paper, you know, the comics in it. Do you remember that? And do you remember that the comics were in color? Remember, on weekdays they were black and white, but on Sunday you'd get them in color. Did you ever take a magnifying glass and look at the color? I mean, it's a whole bunch of little dots and they're all funny pattern and all that, but you get a take the magnifying glass away and it's, oh, you see the picture. And really any photograph is just a lot of little dots. even what Raph has of Johann on his cell phone. They're just little tiny dots. But our eye puts them together. And it just, so there's things about God that we have to see and put together and show other people. Okay. And Romans 8:29 is talking there about the fact that God in his wisdom, you know, has made us so that we'll be conformed to the image of his Son. That's what he set out to do way back before even the world began. He did this kind of thing. And so it says there, for whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. So Jesus Christ is firstborn. He's the first, and then we follow. We're like him. So what God is telling us here is that he wants us to become like the Lord Jesus Christ, and that people will recognize, you know, that Jesus Christ is the first, but we'll be so much like him that he'll still be the first. Raph, are you the oldest in your family?
Yes,
you're the oldest. Everybody knows that in your family.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And can they tell somehow?
No.
Not really.
My brother Josh is 35 and his hair is gray and he's got a bushy beard. And
isn't that something?
His belly looks like he's in his 50s.
Isn't that something?
And when I see him, it's like, wow, that gene missed me.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah. But if he wanted to look like you, he could shave his beard and color his hair dark like yours. Then he'd sort of look like you, wouldn't he? But that's not what God's trying to do to us, is he? Yeah, Raph's thinking about that. No, that would be a good thing. No, no, he'd still look like he's 50. Yeah, amen. Yeah, yeah. So Jewish culture, that idea of firstborn had great preeminence. The firstborn would take over if the father died. He would get not only the all the goods and wealth, but he would get all the power and that firstborn. That's why when Esau gave up his birthright, he gave up being the firstborn. That's what he sold to his brother Jacob, is being the firstborn. And we see here that this depicts that privileged status that they had. And of course we know that God is perfect in all his ways. Isn't that true?
Amen.
God is perfect. And of course his attributes are perfect. His love for us is perfect. And so he then deserves that preeminence, because he's done those things for us. He deserves that. There's nothing, absolutely nothing wrong with God saying that his name is Jealous. That's one of the names of God. He deserves to get all the glory and worship, and so he has every right to be jealous. We don't. You know, for us it's a selfish thing, but for God it's a reality. So then here's Colossians chapter 1 and verse number 18. And when my wife and I were in Bible college, the theme verse for the college was Colossians 1:18. And he is the head of the body, the church, who is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in all things he might have the preeminence. And that was, on the logo for our Bible college, that was the verse that they had, Colossians 1:18. And Dave reads that when he reads about the fact that he created everything, and because they were created by him and for him and all that. So Jesus deserves to get the preeminence.
Amen.
Amen. Yep, he needs to be number one. And then we are number two. talked about this last week. He's number one and we're number two. No.
Jesus others
than
you.
What's that?
Jesus others
than
you.
Jesus others than you is how we had an acronym or acrostic for joy. But Jesus needs to be number one. We need to be number zero. Because see, if he's one and we're two, then well, when we don't necessarily need him, then we're all we need, you know. You'll get him eventually, Raph. I hope you do. He's bothering me too. It will fly. So one of these days, and it could be soon, could be today, we're going to gather around the Lord Jesus Christ up in heaven. Won't that be great?
What a gathering.
Amen.
How about Canada? Is that what you said?
What a gathering.
Oh, what a gathering. Okay, I don't hear real well. I heard, how about Canada? And I thought, oh, okay, we can go to Canada with him if he wants. Yeah, ask my wife, Kitty. I'm always, you know, I don't ever hear her quite right. It's quite funny, you know.
We do that all the time.
This morning she said something. I can't remember what it was. And she said, I thank God for a shower. And I thought she was saying something about, you know, the hall and the bower. And I couldn't figure out what in the world was she talking about. It just, you know, my brain just couldn't compute that. So.
Yeah, on the house, it's always, what?
Yeah. I saw that there's a T-shirt that I should get. It says on the T-shirt, it says, my wife says I don't listen to her. And then underneath it says, I think that's what she said. Yeah. So, but we'll gather. What a gathering. Yes. Amen. Amen. What a gathering. And the Canadian people will be there that know Jesus as well. Praise the Lord. Okay. And of course, we're going to be singing up there. That's why it's good to practice down here. You know, we'll sing a new song up there. Amen. It'll be fantastic. And I'm not sure if everybody will have perfect voices and be able to sing very well up there, or we'll have ears that won't care. You know, I don't know which it'll be. You know, but. It'll be incredible to sing his praise, amen. And of course, he will have the preeminence then. You know, every knee will bow and every tongue will confess, you know, that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God. And that'll be a good thing. All right, we're going on to another sheet. So, Brother John, I'll give you a few this way and if you would help, and I'll take a few this way. Back here. So his purpose, that everything he would have the preeminence. Thank you. Thank you for helping. Okay. So we'll finally understand God's fulfilled purpose in our life. And, you know, that's to conform us to the image of Jesus Christ. Remember, conforming is to have a mold and press something into it so it fits that mold and comes out looking exactly like what that mold was meant to be. So we're conformed to the image of Jesus Christ. And that's going to happen. It will finally happen. It'll be great. And and of course, this one is for Dave, right, Dave? No more heartache of sin, and no more bodily pain, sickness,
yeah,
and all that kind.
It.
What's that?
I won't miss it.
Won't miss that. No, we sure won't. Won't miss the sin part. Won't miss the aches and pains. It's just amazing. You know what's going to happen. It'll be fantastic. It really will.
Hallelujah.
Yeah. Yeah. Ah, it's going to be so great to finally be like Jesus Christ. It'll be really great. Amen?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it'll be just incredible. And sometimes we get caught up with the things like, hey, we'll be able to walk through walls, and, you know. We might be able to do that, you know, be okay, but the great thing will be we won't sin.
Amen.
That really be the greatest thing. You know, we won't disappoint God. We won't ever let him down. We won't ever feel guilty. You know, those kind of things. It'll be great.
Amen.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, it'll be great. And the first time in our life we'll actually be able to say, I'm totally, completely like the Lord Jesus Christ. Right now, we're like him sometimes, but that old man we're still carrying around, and we just drag him around with us. Isn't that terrible? Of course, the Lord Jesus Christ is going to be high and lifted up, and he'll be on that heavenly throne. We'll be giving him the preeminence, and that's what this section is all about. So then we go on here to the product of an abiding Christian. And we know, you know, that Ford Motor Company knows what its product is supposed to be. Isn't that true? It knows. You know, Aero Shirt Company knows what its product is supposed to be. If they're still even in business, who knows? Behringer Electronics knows what their product's supposed to be. Isn't that right, Tony? Yep. Yeah, they know what their, you know, the American Chair Company knows what its product is supposed to be. Am I right?
Yes.
Huh? Foster Grant knows what its product's supposed to be. Sunglasses, if you don't know. Amen. You know, I mean, it's just incredible, those kind of things, when you think about it. They know what their product, you know, the church hardly knows what their product is supposed to be. A lot of churches think their product is a nice social club. That's what they think their product is. Some churches think their product is a fat bankroll. That's what they think their product is. Yeah. A lot of times as Christians, we don't realize, what is our product? What should we be producing? Yeah. What are we supposed to put out? Let me ask you a question. Do the branches of an apple tree know what they're supposed to put out?
Mm-hmm. Apples.
Apples. That's amazing. Yeah, do the vines of a grapevine know what they're supposed to put out?
Grapes.
Yeah, grapes. It's just amazing. Isn't that something? You know? Do the stalks of corn know what they're supposed to produce? Isn't it amazing, amazing, amazing?
And within the fruits, the seed.
And the fruit has the seed to produce more of. Yep, that's the truth. Yep. So here we are in John chapter 15. Here's the vine and the branches. In my afternoon message, this will come up just a little bit today. But we know that, you know, if we're part of the vine, if we're trusting Jesus Christ as our Savior, we're part of that vine. Then we know that our fruit is going to be Christ-likeness. We're going to have fruit and be like Christ. You know, are we more like Christ today than we were yesterday? I sure hope so. Yeah, that's my goal. Hope it's your goal. Amen. So let me ask you the question, what does fruit mean? What does fruit mean? Okay, I'll get to you, Kitty.
I said it's the result of something. You know.
It's the result of something, okay. And
well, in this sentence, it says that Christ is the vine and we're the branches, and our fruit is Christ-likeness.
Christ-likeness. Mm-hmm. Yep.
Well, it's kind of the end result of a lot of different things taking place that eventually produce the fruit.
Okay.
You know, there's a lot of things.
Processes going on. Yeah. Yeah. Isn't it a recognizable and reproducible product of whatever living organism it is? Mm-hmm. You know? As long as it's not GMO, yeah, genetically modified. Yeah, I hope our church doesn't get GMO. I think you get the other versions of the Bible in, it'll be GMO church, yeah. Genetically modified, because this, here's the right gene pool, if you will, and they'll mess with it, yeah. Yep, very good. But, you know, a fruit is something that you can recognize. You know, we all this time of year know what those big orangey kind of things with that little green stem going like this, you know, they're for sale everywhere, you know. I saw one at the market for sale, Raff, $500 for one pumpkin.
Okay, how big was it?
Yeah, it was pretty big, you know, it was on a pallet, you know. Is that what they're figuring?
People aren't even doing that because it's so big they don't know what to do with it.
What to do with it.
Yeah.
I've seen the seeds from the inside of those, and they're big as my thumb. I mean, they're just great big seed, you know. And the seeds sell for a lot of money if you want to, you know, grow that kind. But, you know, we can identify that. We look at it, we say, you know, I mean, somebody at least taught us. Pumpkin, you know, we know what that is. You know, we also see the bright red things about this size in your hand, and we know what those are this time of year. Up here, we know them as apples. You know, down south, they're about this size, and they're not necessarily red, and they're, but apples, you know, we know what those are.
That 23 frost thing.
You're right, yeah.
That's why they technically will grow in North Carolina or Tennessee, and they won't grow at all in South Carolina.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, yeah. But they don't taste good down there. They really don't. But we've had them. Don't ever go south and get cider. It is the worst stuff you have ever tasted. Ugh. We learned that the hard way. We youth leaders, you know, and we decide we're going to have a fall special, and the kids are all in, and we got gallons of cider and donuts to go with it, you know. Boy, that up here in the north, boy, that'd be, you know, wow, that'd be great. And the parents kept saying, you better bring some soda pop, so we didn't buy any, but they brought in some, you know, and of course it went like that, and all these gallons of cider, nobody'd drink it. The genie and I tasted it, went, ugh, this horrid
like
stuff.
Vinegar?
No, it's just, it's like tasteless, and it tastes more like bug guts, and it just, you know, it just, it's not good. All they do with it down there is distill it, you know, or ferment it to make hard cider. That's all they want it for down there. So here, Jeannie and I have got all these gallons of cider, you know, to take home because it's left over, and we're the poor students who need to have, you know, y'all take that home with you, you know. Oh boy, oh boy. We took a lot of it back to the store. We had a couple of them already opened, you know. One glass out of each one, you know. Oh, fruit, but you know what it is. Amen. So two definitions we're looking at it in our lesson here about fruit are found in the Bible. One of them, of course, is the fruit of the Spirit. Then the other is the fruit of souls. The Bible seems to talk about it in two ways. And they kind of go hand in hand. You know, when you're full of the Holy Spirit, then you'll produce souls. And to be able to produce souls, you'll need to be full of the Holy Spirit. And if you're going about that, the Holy Spirit will show you, you know, what things you need. So we start here with the idea of the fruit of the Spirit. And this definition that we have here of fruit bearing comes by the Spirit, and the fruit of the Spirit. Kind of redundant to have the same sentence there, but it's there for you. So just like the sap flowing from the vine to the branches, you know, we'll bear fruit in our Christian character when we allow the Holy Spirit to work in our life. We just need to do that. If we're honest before God and say before God, God, I want my life to be what it can be in Christ Jesus. Holy Spirit, show me what needs to go out, what needs to come in. You know, show me.
Amen.
He'll show you. You know, he really will. But too often we see people just sit in the pew and could care less. They just want to be, you know, they just want to put in their hour for God. I'm not talking to you folks, but there's other churches, other times, other places that, you know, that's what they do. We just wanna, you know, we gotta give God our hour this week. Yeah. But if you really want to abide in Christ, you know, and be pleasing to Him, then ask the Holy Spirit to show you, and He'll flow.
You don't want to run over an hour either.
Oh no! You surely don't. Yeah, you surely don't. I suggested one time to a man who was grumbling about the church he was going to, and I said, well, hey, there's a good church, you know, over the other side of town you could go to that. You know, they're a fine church, and stick with the King James and all that, and it'd be a fine church. He said, no, that pastor goes past 12 o'clock. I couldn't go.
Yeah, that's true.
Well, why don't you put in your mind the church is from 11 to 1, and maybe he lets you out early. Wouldn't that be nice?
Right.
You know? I mean, just put that in your mind and... Wow, we got out early today, you know. It was 12:30. Wow, praise God, we got out early. Yeah. People don't think that way, right? Nope. So, in the spring, you know, we notice that leaves and fruit start to grow. Well, you know, the spring produces the leaves and, of course, fruit later. And so we know that. So we ought to, just like the trees. You know, the leaves are that we're saved. We go around telling people we all of a sudden have a new vocabulary.
Mm-hmm.
You know? And my vocabulary changed. I'm no longer saved from a car accident. I'm spared from my car accident. But I am saved from the hell I deserve. You know? I changed my vocabulary. I used the word saved sparingly. You know? Yeah. So I know what it means now. Amen. So of course all of us should know in the room, but maybe some by way of the internet don't know. But Galatians chapter 5 and verse 22 and 23, we have the fruit of the Spirit. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law. So, here it is. Now, I want to know there, Blaine, does your Bible say the fruits of the Spirit is, or the fruit?
Fruit,
singular. So, how come we have all of those listed if it's a singular fruit class? Because it's okay, so we got a lot of apples on there, but it's the fruit of the tree. Yeah.
It's all one.
All one. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Now, you know what some people have thought, and, you know, this is all right. The fruit of the Spirit is love, and out of love then comes the joy and the peace and long-suffering, the gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, and temperance. So, you know, joy is, you know, love rejoicing, and peace is love in patience, and long-suffering there is love in patience, I guess, you know.
Long-suffering I've got is love enduring.
Love enduring, yep, okay. And gentleness is love.
Caring.
And goodness is love.
In openness,
and faith is?
Love believing.
Love believing, yep. And meekness is?
Love submitting.
Submitting, and temperance is love?
Overcoming.
overcoming. Well, you know, that's pretty good. I'd preach there, brother.
there
you go.
I think you've already preached it. That's why it's here.
It probably is. I think it is. But, you know, that's you know, one way to look at it. You know, the fruit of the Spirit is love, and all these other things happen because of it.
That's a little bit, some Muslims will kind of use that.
Yeah.
It's like, you know, love brings all this stuff.
Uh-huh.
That they focus on love as the only thing.
Yeah.
The rest of 22 and 23, which
yeah.
are related but different.
Right.
Because you can't add on to the Bible if you
that's right.
put everything in it.
That's right. Yeah. One of the things that you need to understand about the fruit of the Spirit is you cannot in yourself produce these qualities.
Amen. True.
Yeah. If you can produce them, they're not of the Holy Spirit. So the love that's being talked about here is love when we don't... Brother, can you... I don't even look at that there. Okay, thank you. Much better. But, you know, the love is when people aren't being lovely. You know, Jesus says, love your enemies. You know, are they people you really, you know, hey, you know, you got this gun to my head, but I'd really like you to come over to the house and, you know, we'll have a meal and watch some TV together. And, you know, I really would like to, you know, have you call me every so often, you know. They got a gun to your head, or worse, they got a sword to your neck, you know. But, you know, we're told to love our enemies.
That's right.
You know? And
there's enough of them to go around.
There sure are, yeah, there sure are. But you can't muster that in yourself. You know, you can't muster that. You know, wasn't it easy enough for all of us to love Holly when we first met her? And we all just said, yeah, we can love her. That's Devin's future wife. We can love her. You know, and we could just, oh, boy, that's easy. Yeah. But the enemies that are out there, to love them, got to be from God. Can't do it. Same way with joy. Yeah. Can you have joy at a funeral? And it's your loved one's funeral.
Well, if they're saved.
Yeah. But, I mean, your emotion isn't joy, you know. You had your hand up about something.
Oh, this is, here again, according to the Seventh-day Adventists, verse 18, they call a heretic. But if you're led of the Spirit, you're not under the law.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. Yeah, they want to stay under the law.
They actually consider Paul a heretic, just as Rome does.
Isn't that something?
It came out.
Wow, yeah, they consider him a heretic because he said that, verse 18 of Galatians 5.
In Acts 12.
Oh, yeah.
Well, they're basically Jewish, the Seventh-day Adventists.
Right, yeah, they follow the law. And
they worship the law.
Yes.
Not the God of the Bible.
Right.
Specifically, they worship the Sabbath.
Yep, they worship the Sabbath, yep. Yep. Yeah. And to not be under the law would be a terrible thing for them.
Pastor?
Yes.
As we grow spiritually, when it says, what is the song? It says, into the heart of Jesus, deeper and deeper I go. Seeking
yes.
the reason why I should know myself.
Right.
And I've heard that if you take each one of these fruits of the Spirit, and that God systematically takes you through each one, and then you go back again, and you learn a little bit more.
Learn more of those, each one. Yes.
What is the fruit of the Spirit that is predominant?
Right.
That's kind of interesting.
That's probably very true. Yeah, that he teaches us and brings us through each of these. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. You know.
Some of these
are tough, yes. Yep, the long suffering can be tough, and the you know, and of course the meekness can be tough, the temperance, keeping ourselves under control, that kind of thing. Yeah.
It's like
No, they're all tough.
They're all tough?
Yeah.
What's that, Jeannie?
That's why it can't be duplicated to the flesh.
That's why the flesh can't do it. I mean, it can only do it for so long. You know, the flesh can only do it for so long. It can fake it for a while, but, you know.
I got a guy upset on the street.
Yeah.
I gave him $2 one time against my, he said he's going to pay me back the next day.
Oh, yeah.
Then he came around again and started, they have a dance they do.
Uh-huh.
In fact, some of them are really gifted at it, especially if they know Bible.
Oh, yeah. Well, you don't mean this kind of dance.
Yeah.
Not that. You mean the dance with the words.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So they're fishing.
Yeah.
And I said, do you smoke?
Mm-hmm.
He says, yeah. I said, well, I'm not helping with cigarettes.
Right.
And he had money to buy stuff because he went and got it. And then he came around again and I said, no, you smoke.
Mm-hmm.
And he started giving me the Christian deal. I'm not this or I'm not that.
Yeah.
And I said, no.
Yeah.
Well. He got mad. He was mad.
Yeah.
Good. That's good. I'd say that to him. It was good he was upset.
Right.
They got to learn something.
Yep.
People point out the law when, you know, talk about alcohol or tobacco or in two states so far, marijuana. But it's like
yeah.
they say, oh, that's legal. So why mm-hmm. are you
against
are you
it?
Not necessarily against it, just don't do it.
Ah, yeah.
You're condemning me for it. It's like, okay, do your own thing. It's just not profitable for me.
Yeah.
If all things are lawful, just...
Yeah.
You know, really, you're condemning me because I don't do something that's...
Not
exactly helpful.
Right.
Make
yeah.
them look bad. Right?
Yeah.
That's what it is.
Oh, that's it.
Yeah. Right.
In the Quran, it talks about it's okay to take people's land and
their children,
their wives, and
yep.
kill them. So there are God's laws and there's man's laws.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yep. Quite different.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yeah. So this fruit, it's something that the Holy Spirit's got to do in us, and it's not easy. So, I ask a question. What are some evidences of a fruitful life?
Seeing people get saved.
Okay, seeing people get saved. Well, we just
trials.
Are...
Handling trials in a proper way.
Okay, handling trials in a proper way. Yeah.
Abstaining
from the appearance of evil. Yeah, that's that temperance, isn't it? Yeah.
Growing in the knowledge of Christ.
Okay, growing in the knowledge of Christ.
Wisdom.
You know, that's long suffering. Wouldn't it be nice to take a pill and be holy?
Mm.
You know, we just take one, you know, or if we could just, you know, rip out a page of our Bible and eat it, and from then on we'd be holy. Wouldn't that be great? We'd all like that. Never sin again, never have an evil thought, never have... Wouldn't that be, that'd be really something.
Well, if it's a pill that kills you, it'll...
yeah, that'd work. There you go. Yeah. Hey. Yeah, yeah. Don't tell those TV evangelists. They'll probably come out with one. This pill guaranteed to make you holy.
Here's some cyanide.
Yeah, yeah. It's got Kool-Aid flavored pill here, yes.
But not in this life.
Not in this life. Okay. So, you know, is the spirit-filled, you know, fruit-bearing life all emotions and display, speaking in tongues and, you know, barking like dogs and all that sort of thing, a lot of this stuff,
no.
You know, we gotta do all this stuff, huh? How about taking our hanky out, running around, woo! Yay, I'm in the spirit now. Woo, woo, woo. Is that it?
As long as it's a clean hanky.
Yeah. You know it's not clean when you open it up and it sounds like Velcro. That you know that, don't you? Yeah, it's not clean. This one, I've wiped my glasses on, and it's got, I don't know, it's got some stuff there that won't ever come out. I bleached one hanky so much, all of it came out, but then the hanky just shredded. It just, yeah. But, you know, is that what it's all about, the spirit-filled life? It's not what it's all about?
No. Hmm. And especially as speaking tongues, people take that to the extreme, the this way and the other way.
Yes.
It's like they say you have to speak my language, know Jesus, or you have to, you know, be like Pentecostals or whatever. It's like,
right.
Hey, you can, if you know the language, we got gospel tracts. If you don't speak somebody's language,
right, we've got it in your.
It's easier to hear.
Yes.
In their tongue,
right. Yeah, makes sense to them. Yes, yeah. Dave?
It's very convenient we left out when they have these things.
Uh-huh.
It's all emotional, but they never tell you you can lose it for salvation.
Oh. I mean, the Pentecostals always say that, yeah. Yeah.
It bugs me because if somebody happens to get saved, I don't know if I've told you this before, you tell them, glory to God, you got to save them. By the way, you can lose it.
Uh-huh.
They don't tell them up front. They slide it in later.
Later, yeah.
Yeah, when you got control of the person.
Yeah.
When you really get control of them.
Yes.
Yeah. Now I'm not having which one?
Now you're not having the gentleness and the goodness.
The wall, right there.
Yeah.
It's making me perspire.
Making you perspire, yeah.
But it's hard when you're confronting that.
Oh, yeah.
All the time.
Yes.
Where they're going against what God teaches in His Word. It's,
right.
Those are, you know, Jesus came to save sinners, save the lost, have compassion on them.
Right.
You can't do that without the Holy Spirit.
Yeah. Then people say, are you one of those once saved, always saved bunch?
Yeah. Yeah. But they ask a lot of questions, yeah.
I had somebody tell me that on Facebook. I wrote it.
Wrote it on Facebook. Yeah.
Once they said, O-S-A-S.
Oh, yeah.
Something about that. And I had to type it out saying, for the question mark. I didn't know what it
was.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah.
Once saved, always saved.
Once saved, always saved. O-S-A-S.
She is really in a bad way.
I've been told that personally many times.
Uh-huh. Of course, the reason they say that is they think we then believe we have a license to sin. Because we're always saved, we can do whatever we want, we're still going to heaven. But, yeah, God forbid is what Scripture says.
We do have a license to sin, we just shouldn't use it.
Uh-huh.
We have a license for forgiveness, so.
Right.
We're free from the law.
Yeah.
Right.
But.
Yeah. Paul said, all things are lawful, so
not all things are profitable.
What happens in Hebrews chapter 12?
Yeah.
The chastening. The
chastening, yeah. So, yeah, it's quite interesting. Okay, dear ones, the fruit of the Spirit, work on it this week. Amen?
Amen.
You know, work on that this week. And we'll see God do some things. Let's pray together. Father, thank you again for being able to look at these ideas and in Sunday school the way we do. And Lord, we're trying to line some of these things up that we might understand that by abiding in Christ, we know what we're to produce. And we have a purpose, and that is to glorify the Lord Jesus Christ. And then we have to produce fruit, the fruit of the Spirit in our life, and the fruit of souls for the glory of Christ. And so continue to use each of us that way. May our morning service be to your glory. Thank you again for all that you are and do. We love you and need you. And so may you be pleased with us in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Lord bless.